Edward II is remembered for losing Scotland. He's criticised for lacking the determination and the single-mindedness of his father, Edward I, which is probably fair enough. But Edward, he was a competent leader, and he was a brave warrior. His problem was that he was in love with one of his noblemen, Piers Gaveston. And I mean, who could blame him? Look at that guy. Oh my God. If I had a time machine, I would be going back to the 14th century just so I could get lost in that guy's eyes. Now, unfortunately for Edward, he didn't have a kind of 14th century Holly Willoughby type who could communicate his feelings to the nation and drum up some empathy for him. And so the English nobles, they had Piers Gaveston killed, and Edward, he was trapped in a loveless marriage with a foreign woman who secretly hated him. He was married to Isabella, who was the daughter of the King of France. Now, after Bannockburn, there was a very brief period of peace between Scotland and England. And Robert the Bruce, he used this time to work on his excommunication by the Pope. He had been excommunicated after the sacrilegious murder of John Comyn in a church in 1306. The Pope wasn't happy about it because sacrilegious acts in churches, I mean, they're exclusively for priests and for bishops only. And so Robert the Bruce, he called a parliament at Newbattle in March 1320, where a letter was drafted to be sent to the Pope, urging him to accept Robert Bruce as King of Scots and to put pressure on Edward II to do the same. Now, the letter would be penned entirely in Latin, kind of like a Boris Johnson public health announcement, by Bernard de Linton, the abbot of Arbroath Abbey. It would be known as the Declaration of Arbroath. It was ratified on the 6th of April, 1320. And the Declaration of Arbroath, it lambasted Edward I for being a wolf in sheep's clothing. Although, to be fair, in Arbroath, that sort of thing is considered quite sexy. It told the Scottish origin story. It listed the 112 Scottish kings. It boasted that Scotland had never been conquered, not by Pict, not by Britain, not by Viking. It said that Scotland, under no circumstance, would accept the rule by England, and that if Robert Bruce allowed Scotland to be subjugated by England, then he would be replaced as king. And importantly, it said that if the people deemed Robert Bruce to be an ineffectual king, then they had the right to replace him. And this is the important part of the Declaration of Arbroath. This idea that the king is beholden to his subjects as much as they are to him. It's the first mention of constitutionalism in European history. And that's why the Declaration of Arbroath is so important. It was used as a kind of draft for things like the American Declaration of Independence. Now, as impressive as it all was, the Pope still didn't lift his excommunication. And so Robert the Bruce, he went back to carrying out raids in the north of England. He laid waste to the north of England in an attempt to bully Edward II into accepting him as King of Scots. It's a bit like when your big brother would sit in you and tell you to stop hitting yourself until you accepted that he was master of the universe, you know? And things, they weren't going well for Edward II. Not only was he being dominated by Robert the Bruce in the north, but in 1326, his wife Isabella refused to return from France, instead taking a lover, a guy by the name of Roger Mortimer. And Isabella and Roger, they launched a successful rebellion against Edward II. He was ousted and replaced with his 15-year-old son, Edward III. And in 1327, there would be another English expedition north to take on Robert the Bruce. But the English army, they were absolutely terrified of Robert the Bruce and his guerrilla tactics. The boy king himself was almost snatched by James Douglas in Wearside when he found out that his parents were in a tapas restaurant a couple of hundred metres away. And Edward II, he died in the autumn of 1327 by natural causes. And when I say by natural causes, what I mean is that Isabella and Roger had been murdered by means of a red-hot poker shoved up his arse. If that is considered natural causes, then Jesus really makes me rethink my grandparents' death. Christ alive, my God. And so public opinion, it quickly turned on Isabella and Roger after the murder of Edward II. And the English, they were growing weary of the war against Scotland. And so they sought peace. And the Treaty of Edinburgh was ratified the 17th of March, 1328. And finally, England accepted Scotland's independence as a kingdom. It accepted Robert the Bruce as the King of Scots. And they were supposed to return the Stone of Destiny, which had been taken by Edward I in 1296. They didn't. They kept hold of it for another 700 years. So there you go, Greece. You know, you've only got, what, another 500 odd years before they give back the stuff that they stole. It'll be fine, it'll be all good. And then in October 1328, the Pope finally lifted his excommunication of Robert the Bruce. It meant that Robert the Bruce's life work was finally completed. And he died the following summer. In the summer of 1329, he died at 55 years of age. His body was buried in Dunfermline Abbey, and his heart, as per his request, was embalmed to be taken to the Holy Land by James Douglas. But the problem was, there was no crusades going on at the time, and so the nearest Muslims that James Douglas could pick a fight with were the Moors in the south of France. And so, facing his imminent death, James Douglas, before charging towards the Moors, he took Robert the Bruce's embalmed heart, he threw it in front of him, and he shouted, "Onward, brave hearts!" and charge towards the enemy. These are words that have gone down in Scottish history. They've echoed through the ages, even inspiring a Hollywood blockbuster film about the completely wrong Scottish patriot. That's how inaccurate that film is, that not even the title is correct. Now, the Bruce's heart, it was recovered from the battlefield and it was taken to Melrose Abbey, where it was buried. It's actually been dug up and buried three times, although going down and back up again is what hearts are used to, you know. And so Robert the Bruce's infant son David became David II. And my God, he had a hell of a lot to live up to. And that is who I'm going to speak to you guys about next time. Thank you so much for listening.